perverts only.
It's absolutely brilliant. I mean, look, there's almost no production costs. You can't take your eyes off it. It's incredibly realistic. Where do they get actors who can do this?
Pittsburgh. That's in the USA.
Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh.
There is a fabric to the city of Pittsburgh that puts a little bit of a stamp, I think, on all of us.
I think I must have sang Razzle Dazzle 80,000 times in Pittsburgh. Have hat and cane, we'll travel. And that was sort of me.
Pittsburgh has always been wonderful for me as far as recognizing the fact that I am from there and bringing me back.
I miss the distinct ethnic neighborhoods that were right up against each other. And you got that sense of the whole world being in one place.
There's something humbling about growing up in that town. You know, it's like this sort of shady, dirty, smoky impression that people have.
I draw on it constantly when I'm thinking of characters. I draw on it constantly when I'm thinking about underdog stories. It's just a part of my fabric now, just like my big crazy nose and, you know, my Pittsburgh accent.
As an artist, it helps to be just a little bit alienated. And Pittsburgh sometimes, by never giving you too much kudos, by always keeping you a little bit on your toes, keeps an artist still hungry.
Everybody has always said it's sort of the best kept secret. Pittsburgh, everybody's from Pittsburgh.
In 1905, Pittsburgh was the mecca where Adolf Zucker, who ended up creating Paramount, came to Pittsburgh to see what this new business was about.
The first Nickelodeon was in Pittsburgh. The first radio station, KDKA, was in Pittsburgh. The first public television station, QED, was in Pittsburgh. So we have this very rich sort of history and background of being innovative.
Harry Warner, legend has it, was selling pants at Kaufman's and kept seeing the lines going into the motion picture theater, the first motion picture theater in the history of the world. And he and his brothers apparently went in for a nickel. They stole three shows. They had to kick them out. And they left that theater. They shook hands and they say, we're in the motion picture business.
Then you've got this other side of the Mellons, the Fricks, the Carnegies, who all were enormous benefactors of the arts, knew how intrinsic it was to culture.
There were sort of the historic people that I knew that had come from Pittsburgh, which gave you a sense of pride. Gene Kelly, for me, because I remember one of my first shows at Ben Gross's. The paper came out the next day and it said, will he be the next Gene Kelly? And it sort of gives you a whole sense of, wow.
Looking back, I feel so naive because I was so sheltered. I had no idea that there was an entertainment industry. The people really did that for a living. But, you know, it was like doing radio and then thinking, well, people do this. You know, there must be jobs.
I find myself in commonality with a lot of people where you were getting training in Pittsburgh while you weren't realizing it. My mother used to do plays at the White Barn Theater in Irwin, Pennsylvania. And she made me read lines with her, and I hated doing that because there would be swearing, and I'm not gonna swear at my mom. But, you know, little did I know that I was absorbing that, even though it never occurred to me to be a writer.
The Playhouse, it's probably the best thing that ever happened to me as far as a proving ground for learning, because I really learned what, quote, show business was all about. And I always say to young people, I wish there was a place you could go like that.
We did Best Foot Forward. And, you know, there's the Barrel House, the Boogie Woogie, and the Blues.
I did a lot of stage managing work and production work around town. So I worked at Pittsburgh Public when it was still in the Carnegie Library space, and then at the Civic Light Opera for three wonderful summer seasons.
I was just so lucky to fall into Pittsburgh Civic Light Opera. My sisters and I went down and auditioned for The Sound of Music. We had no lessons, nothing. You know, we didn't even have 8x10s. We had little Polaroids we took in the backyard, you know what I mean? You know?
this was a phenomenal breeding ground for knowing that I had a desire, and really I could fulfill that within the town. Just if you wanted to make a living, that was another story.
They've made it impossible, sadly, to make a living in the arts in Pittsburgh and raise your family and send them to good schools. So it forces people to leave who are very talented.
Coming from Pittsburgh, it would have been very helpful had there been an organization where I could have gone and said, here's my script, help me get it out there. And the thing is, there are all these talented people and there's all these talented teachers and places in Pittsburgh, but they're all fragmented.
I remember my first exposure to a movie set was the Monroeville Mall when they were shooting Dawn of the Dead. And that was a big experience for me, and I remember Marty Schiff coming out to pick me up at the front entrance in a golf cart and driving me around. I wish I would have had more of that kind of exposure, because that was the first time I saw filmmaking.
If we could provide a service where there really is mentoring built into this, I mean, I think that's a big part of Sundance, and that's a big part of USC's film school, is Mr. Spielberg and Mr. Lucas show you how to make movies.
One of the things that I would want to do is try and expose people from Pittsburgh to how we make these shows, what a week of a television show is, because that informs how you write for that show.
The more people you mentor, the more they will continue to work with you because they feel like you've supported them, and I think that's the way it's supposed to work. It's a very small community, and so you make contact with people, you try and help people, and then they'll help you.
Imagine, with all the goodwill and all the talent that we're talking about, movies that are being mentored by people like Antoine Fuqua, Steven Soderbergh, Rob Marshall, writers working with Michael Chabon, Peter Ackerman, actors working with Jeff Goldblum and Michael Keaton, everyone collectively trying to find material that's not only good, but that means something to them.
Pittsburgh is the American experience. It's about people who work hard and care about themselves and their neighbors. And I just think those kinds of basic human dreams are something that are universal and are great for basic storytelling.
And there she goes. It's a long one to left field. And you can kiss it goodbye.
Maybe it's about the 1960 Pirates and Bill Mazeroski. Maybe it's about Frank O'Harris, but there's so much richness to the kinds of stories we can tell, and we have the creative community who can tell them.
I think there are 7 million stories you could do about Pittsburgh. I mean, I could do my own little version of Billy Elliot, this young dancer in Pittsburgh, you know, when it's not cool to be a dancer.
Entertainment is a $130 billion industry. That's staggering.
First page, whenever I come back to LA, is computer revolution, the new interactive thing, and I keep thinking, CMU's Entertainment Technology Center is doing the exact same thing. The difference is, we have no place to put it in Pittsburgh once it leaves there.
Even on the television shows where we never considered doing visual effects 10 years ago, every show we do substantial visual effects. You know, on West Wing, a lot of the things that have been generated out of the computer departments are the mathematical models that allow us to take a Virgin airliner, shoot it, and then go into the editing room and for only about $5,000 turn it into Air Force One.
I would love to see the city continue and to flourish. And the way to do that, obviously, is to bring in new business. But there's no tax incentives in the city, no tax incentives in the state. There's nobody who's reaching out to the film business as a business. And I don't think they understand what it could do for the city. You know, what it actually brings, just not only in revenue, but it brings a pool of talent, it brings an excitement to a city. It helps with bringing and keeping young people in a city, which Pittsburgh is a city that has a lot of trouble with that. And, you know, it's a great city. It's a very livable city. It has so many great things about it, yet there aren't enough opportunities there. And, you know, this is the kind of business that the city should be reaching out to.
I hope what Steeltown can do for Pittsburgh is start a real dialogue between the professionals who are out working at the top of their game right now and the city.
Some place is going to kind of grab the production center in the United States, because New York and Los Angeles, Chicago have already priced themselves out of the market. And we're just waiting to see who's going to do it.
I think every great movie is an underdog story. It's about people succeeding in ways that you didn't expect them to succeed, accomplishing things you didn't expect them to accomplish, and that is the city of Pittsburgh, and it's inspirational in that way.
You never stop being a Pittsburgher. Everybody has these strong ties back to their community, and it's hard to not want to participate in something that can help Pittsburgh.
When Pittsburgh calls, I'm there, because it let me dream, it inspired me. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for what Pittsburgh offered, and that's something I'd love to give back in any way I can.
Sure talk funny. Where you born at?
Poland.
Oh. Is that near Pittsburgh?
Pittsburgh has the most unique accent. It's not Eastern, it's not, you know, Jun's going downtown. Downtown? We're in the iron and steel business. My mother irons and my father steels. Boom, boom.
I love Pittsburghese because of that whole, like, hey, Jun's guy's going down having a beer and at. I love the answering, you know, ending every sentence in and at. You gonna have a wedding in at? You know? You gonna have a bar mitzvah in at? You know, and the whole, like my dad used to say growing up, red off the table. What the hell does red off the table mean?
I remember my father used to answer the telephone. He'd say, everything goes up at the end. Hello? You want to go to the show? Hi. You want to come over for dinner?
I used to do it real well, but now, you know, it's kind of gone away. You know, but sometimes when you're doing a wash, you know, or you're redding up around a Haas, you know, it'll, you know, it can creep back in there, you know.
Hang out the arms of Elmo. We're gonna